Hello and welcome again to one more of our series on physiology concepts. Today we're going to talk about the transportation across the plasma membrane, and I want to remind you that the cell is surrounded by a membrane that is made up of two layers of phospholipids, and we're going to see how substances are moving in and out across this plasma membrane. So there are two ways by which things move in and out of the cell. It's either by a passive process or an active process. What are the two major differences over here that we have to understand? First, in the passive process, no energy is required. There's no ATP that's going to be used up by the cell. In active transport, we need to use ATP. In the passive, we are moving substances from one side of the cell that has the greater concentration to the lower concentration. So we are moving substances down a concentration gradient. Over here, we are doing the exact opposite. We are moving substances from an area of lower concentration to higher concentration, which is very difficult to do. This is why we will need ATP. These are the mechanisms of passive transport, filtration, diffusion, two types of diffusion and osmosis. And these are the mechanisms of active transport, which are going to be discussed in another presentation. So for today, we are discussing passive transport mechanisms. This is the first one, filtration. What happens in filtration is water in a certain area is going to carry some of the dissolved solutes and move them out, force them out. We can see this happens very often in the kidney, where we are trying to take substances out of the blood and filter them out to the kidney. These are waste products, and we want to get rid of them. Now, what is the force that is going to push the water and the dissolved substances out? This is hydrostatic pressure. Very important. So, hydrostatic pressure is the force that is exerted on this membrane, and it is due to the volume of water that is in this area here. This is a small capillary blood vessel. So the water present here creates a force which we call the hydrostatic pressure, and it will push the fluid out. Remember that the plasma membrane is very thin, and it will always keep larger particles in. So as from the previous slide, red blood cells and bigger particles are never going to be moved out. So where does this come from? Really, the volume of fluid here, or the blood here, is represented by the blood pressure. So the greater the blood pressure, the more filtration will occur, the greater the hydrostatic pressure, and vice versa. So remember, this is the hydrostatic pressure, the pressure created by a volume of water. The greater the hydrostatic pressure, the greater the filtration. So if a person has low blood pressure, if they are bleeding and they lost some blood, the filtration across the kidney is going to be far less than the normal. And as soon as the paramedics come to this person, they have to administer fluids in order to increase the blood pressure, increase the blood volume, bring the hydrostatic pressure back to normal so this person can filter waste out from the blood to the kidneys. The second mechanism is diffusion, and we have two types of diffusion, the simple and the facilitated. In the simple diffusion, simple means it's unassisted. I don't need any help. So if you look here, this is the cell membrane or the plasma membrane. It's a layer of lipids. And outside the cell, I have a higher concentration of solutes. So they will simply diffuse from an area of higher concentration to an area of lower concentration inside. Now, what substances can move through this process? Either they have to be very small to diffuse through, or they have to be lipid-soluble, because remember, lipids can pass through lipids, but if they're not lipid-soluble, they won't be able to pass. Famous examples that pass into and out of the cell by simple diffusion are oxygen and carbon dioxide. So oxygen in the blood outside the cell can move in to give the cell the nutrition. Carbon dioxide that accumulates inside the cell can move out again so that it can be removed as waste. Now, do all substances move at the same rate? No. So there are certain factors that will affect the rate of diffusion, whether they diffuse faster or slower. Increasing the temperature will increase diffusion. Larger molecules will be very slow to diffuse. If we increase the concentration, there's more diffusion. If I have a surface area that has a bigger membrane, definitely substances can diffuse faster. And the more permeable my substance, the more my rate of diffusion. In facilitated diffusion, I need a helper. I need a facilitator. And these helpers or facilitators are actually plasma proteins that are in the plasma membrane itself. We call them carrier proteins. And so we're going to look at carrier-mediated transport. Some of those proteins are very specific for specific substances. And we use this in large molecules, like moving amino acids in and out of the cells and moving glucose in and out of the cell. We're going to look at glucose because this is first how facilitated diffusion occurs. This is my carrier protein. Higher concentration of the substance, this solute is going to move through my carrier. It's going to attach to a specific site, which we call the binding site or the active site. The protein is going to change its shape and sort of squeeze my solute in and release it on the inner side of the cell. So this is how facilitated diffusion works. We're looking at a specific carrier here or transporter, and this is very important. Type of transportation that occurs across our cells. The glucose transporter, GLUT or glucose transporter, is a specific protein that is in the plasma membrane of the cell, and it will specifically transport glucose from outside, from the blood, into the cell. So the cells can use it to make ATP, or the cells can store it if they don't need it immediately. Now, one thing to remember is there is a certain number of those glucose transporters. And if we have too much glucose, more than the number of transporters, the cell is not going to be able to transport any more glucose molecules in. It's going to be saturated, and the rate of diffusion of glucose inside is going to decrease. So we have a concept here that we call transport maximum. It's because I have a limited number of transporters, I'm going to transport a maximum number of glucose molecules. The rest won't be able to come in. They will move from the blood into the urine and be excreted outside the body. Types of membrane carriers or transporters. A uniport is a protein that will allow one solute only to move in one direction, either from inside out or from outside in. A same port has the ability of transporting two substances at the same time in the same direction. So this is simultaneous. I can move those two substances together in the same direction. An antiport has the ability of moving two substances in two different directions. So this solute is leaving at the same time this solute is coming in. The third mechanism of passive transport is osmosis. And in osmosis, we are simply talking about diffusion of water. So again, water will always diffuse from an area of higher concentration of water to an area of lower concentration of water. So if we look over here, if this is my membrane, my semi-permeable membrane, I have a higher concentration of water and the lower, so water will move from this side to that side. So we see that the water level is going to increase. What will keep water from going back? Water here is attracted by those solutes. So those solutes exert a force, and this force will keep pulling water into that region. So we're going to concentrate on this concept, and this is called osmotic pressure. So osmotic pressure is the pressure that is exerted by the solutes to pull the water towards them. And this is very important. Now, this osmotic pressure depends on the osmolarity, the concentration of solutes over here. So if I increase the solutes, if I come and add some sodium to this compartment, I am going to increase the osmotic pressure. I'm going to increase the pull of water. I'm going to get some more water, and this level of water is going to increase. Aquaporins, this is to remind you that movement of water is not simply through osmosis. It can also occur through specific plasma membrane channels. These are proteins that we call aquaporins, and they will again allow water to move from an area of higher concentration to lower concentration. We need to look at these two pressures because we've already mentioned these and see how they work hand in hand. Remember, hydrostatic pressure belongs to the volume of water over here, and it will want to push the water out. Osmotic pressure depends on the concentration of solutes inside here, and it will want to pull the water in. So what is the result? Is water going to move out or is going to be pulled in? It depends on who is stronger. The greater of these is going to be the one that is going to either pull the water or push it out. Since we are talking about osmosis, we're going to talk about osmolarity. So what is osmolarity? It is actually the concentration of solutes in a solution. And from this concept, we need to talk about tonicity. What is tonicity? Is the ability of a solution to change the shape or the tone, this is where this word comes from, of a cell by changing the volume of water inside this cell. So we're going to look at three types of solutions: the isotonic, hypotonic, and hypertonic. Cells can be surrounded by one of these, and how is water going to move in or out of the cell? It depends on this very important rule to remember. Water will always follow the salt. So let's look at an isotonic solution. Isotonic solution means this solution surrounding the cells has exactly the same concentration of solutes as inside the cell. So there is no net movement of water, no water moving in or out of the cell. We call this solution isotonic, and common solutions that we give to patients are normal saline 0.9%. When I don't want to change the shape of their cells, this is what we administer. In hypotonic solution, the solution surrounding the cells here is hypotonic, means the number of solutes is less. I have more solutes inside here, so water will follow the salt. So water is going to be pulled into those cells. They might enlarge and swell, and sometimes they might burst, and this is an adverse effect. They might lyse and die, so we have to be very careful ever with giving hypotonic solutions. The last one and the last of our presentation here is hypertonic solutions. If these cells are surrounded by a hypertonic solution where solutes are at higher concentration over here, water will follow the salt, water will be sucked out of those cells, these cells might shrivel and crenate and again die. So this completes our presentation on the passive membrane transport, and thank you for joining us.